You're listening to the Ask Drone You podcast. You ask, we answer your drone questions. Whether you're here to turn your passion into profit or you simply fly for fun, we're a community of learners and teachers who aspire to achieve greatness. We are
Drone You.
Hey everyone, and welcome to another interesting episode of Ask Drone You. As always, my name has not changed. It is still Paul.
And my name is still Rob. Super glad to be here with you guys. Thank you very much for spending a few minutes of your day with us. And don't forget, we want to hear from you. We want to answer your questions. AskDroneU.com is where you can make that happen. So get her done.
Definitely get it done. Look, there's a lot of questions that are out there, and as all these drones and everything constantly evolves, that means there's an opportunity for, that's right, more questions. So that said, send in your questions. Let us know what those are so that we can help, because honestly, it's what we love to do. That said, we've got a great question today, a very interesting question, again, regarding kind of state and local authority on inhibiting flights. This is up in Wisconsin. And it's just another reminder, again, that, and I think that we have actually seen this particular trend in a lot of government, where in government, people will test their authority over and over and over until they get spot checked, which is really annoying because it costs the private sector and the public money to check them, which is never fun. We've got to be smart. We got to be savvy. And as government doesn't like the idea of civilians, quote unquote, flying below the radar, when they constantly test their authority to regulate things that they don't have authority to regulate, it really makes you wonder, does that perpetuate the whole flying under the radar problem? And that'll be our bombshell philosophizing question for today. But why don't we...
we're not even going to answer it.
No, not at all. Why don't we go ahead and get right into today's question?
Because the answer is obvious, but okay.
Hey guys, my name is Jake. I'm a brand new drone pilot, and I just had a question. At Devil's Lake State Park in Wisconsin, I'm sure this is the case with many state parks, but there's like a railroad cutting through it and some bigger roads and even like a little residential area. I was wondering, would it be legal to take off from any of the streets, like the residential area or on the railroad track, and then fly into the state park? Thanks a lot.
Thank you. We appreciate you sending in your question, taking the time to hop on there and do that. AskDroneU.com for your version of the question. So there's a couple different layers to this, right? There's sort of the kind of the macro general. What do you do to get into space that you're generally not supposed to fly in? And that sounds nefarious. I don't mean it to. But then there's also just... controlled airspace, and are you in that? That's number one.
Yeah, and I mean, we already checked the sectionals to make sure that it wasn't controlled airspace on the federal level, as the FAA is the only governing body that does control the airspace. So as Rob alluded to, sometimes cities and states thought that they were doing the politically correct thing by banning drones from takeoff and landing at certain parks. It's a quick reminder too, if you are a DroneU member, or even if you're not a DroneU member, one of the resources available on the DroneU site is the Drone Advocacy Kit. And it is something, it is a tool and a resource that you can use to politely and eloquently work with your state representatives and your city and local representatives to help educate them on what their authority it actually is. And, you know, there was a town of Newton, Massachusetts that tried testing this federal authority, and they got shot down literally in federal court. In fact, we're grateful that here at DroneU, one of our esteemed colleagues was actually a witness in that particular case. That said, I think it's extremely important to mention that, again, states, counties, municipalities, cities, etc., they can limit takeoff and landing from any particular area, but this student is right in that he can take off and land on private property and fly in, right? The whole idea here is that you are operating from outside and flying in. And so, you know, when you think about that, it also is pertinent for national parks. You know, we put that information out almost 5 years ago, and then national parks actually commented on that. And now they're in a whole new realm, as we kind of talked about last month. So that said, remember, the only controlling authority is the FAA. It is also a good idea for all of you drone pilots out there to have that drone advocacy kit on you at any given time, because if a police officer comes up to you and says, look, there's no flying in this park, blah, 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 you can pull out the advocacy kit and say, well, hold on, the authority of the airspace is granted only to the FAA.
Yeah.
Yes, counties and municipalities and cities can inhibit takeoff in their jurisdiction, but if I'm on private property, there's absolutely nothing that they can control. And here's the proof of that.
Well, and to that point, it's one thing, you can't just have it with you. You need to know what's in it and what it says and where to look for whatever you're going to be sharing with a given public servant. But so just one clarification I want to ask you about, and that is because you're saying private property, which is obvious. I mean, if someone gives you the right or the permission to take off from their private property, then you're fine. Mm-hmm. But what about just like a public road or something that's not in the national or not in the park per se?
Public road should actually be okay as well, 100%. But this brings up one of the points of his question, that there's a railroad. You can absolutely not take off and land from the railroad. Not only are there issues with taking off and landing in that particular geolocation, but in addition to that, you really don't want to take off from that area anyway, because of all the magnetic interference from the rails. It's just really not a good idea.
Yeah.
So that said, yes to public, yes to private, but no to the railroads. And in an effort to kind of keep this show short, let's go ahead and end it here. But I think that we answered this question. If you have a question, don't forget, askdroney.com.
Just one last point question, and that is, the ability to fly varies from state to state, or even perhaps, well, probably state to state, right? In terms of state parks, or is that a kind of a national state park thing? I know that doesn't make sense. State park.
The rules do essentially change from state to state, just because of different states have different rules.
Yeah.
I think a lot of states figured out in the last couple of years that they cannot govern airspace whatsoever. And so when it comes to that, there's been kind of like this reversal, this trend of regulations that were even put into place, but are just not being enforced at all.
Right.
So yes, this does vary from state to state. We also do see people all the time on YouTube, on Instagram, and other various forums that constantly, still fly in these areas, because sometimes it's just absolutely ridiculous to inhibit kids from flying in parks. You know, I know that politicians might think that they're doing the right thing by inhibiting people from flying in parks, but I would say that your lack or politicians' lack of foresight is once again evident in the lack of research in this particular subject, because when kids don't have a place to go fly, you know, they're gonna go fly in their backyards. They're gonna go fly in places that could actually be a bigger problem and a bigger challenge, at least safety wise. And so, if you really think about it too, on a national security kind of level, I'm gonna go to that extreme really fast. If our politicians inhibit kids and grown men and women from flying in parks, then what they're doing is they're de-incentivizing kids to learn how to fly, okay? Now, that lack or that de-incentivization could have a very large macro effect, right? Because flying is one of these very minute, nuanced operations that we can do to elicit inspiration and motivation for kids in STEM education. And by inhibiting kids' ability to take flight, we are, at the end of the day, really hurting ourselves and our country's ability to create a stalwart and intelligent engineers and executives and anyone in the science and math, industries. So I would say to politicians who are coming up as we're seeing kind of a tidal change in how things are going down, that if your city or town had inhibited flight in parks, maybe it's time to think about taking that rule off the books, just like they did here.
Here, here. And I'd say the only thing I'd say is, so stop listening to the loud vocal minority.
On that bombshell, that's going to do it for us today. My name is Paul.
And I'm Rob.